which we're going to do right now. Our next panel is called Earth Law, Protecting Nature. Our moderator for this segment is Grant Wilson, who is the executive director and directing attorney of the Earth Law Center. Grant leads the center's expert work on the rights of nature, ecocentric law, water law, international environmental law, and human environmental rights. So Grant, thank you so much for taking time to be here today and to guide this conversation. And I'm going to turn the screen over to you.
Okay, I think this is working. All right, welcome everyone to another exciting event at the Global Freshwater Summit. And thank you to the Missouri Historical Society, to Myra Jackson, and to the many organizers of today's event for inviting us here today. My name is Grant Wilson, as you heard, and I'm the executive director at Earth Law Center. And we are a team of legal professionals that advance a new Earth-centered DNA for our legal system. You can read all about us at earthlawcenter.org. And today I'm calling in from Boulder, Colorado, located within the Boulder Creek watershed and on the occupied homelands of the Arapaho, Cheyenne, and Ute people. Today I will be your moderator. After this brief introduction, I will introduce three amazing speakers. You're in for a treat. They're all experts in emerging legal paradigms that seek to transform the law to respect and restore nature. I call this field of study Earth Law, and here's my quick plug. That's the title of our new law school course book on the subject that I encourage you all to read, lawyers or not. And you can call it Earth Law or ecocentric law. And you can think about this as sort of like human rights law, but for the planet and all its inhabitants. Earth Law includes a variety of legal movements across the United States and globally that seek justice for and restoration of nature. And a particular focus of today's speakers will be the rights of rivers, which is a subset of the larger field of the rights of nature, whether rivers or forests or oceans. And the rights of rivers specifically is a legal movement to challenge the notion that rivers and watersheds are mere human property or a resource to exploit, and instead recognize that the Earth's sacred waters have basic rights, just as humans do. The Mississippi River Basin, along with its 250 tributaries and millions of acres of wetlands, has inherent fundamental rights. It's just that our Western legal system does not yet recognize that. This is beginning to change, as we will hear all about today. Rights of nature and other earth law or ecocentric legal movements are not just a pipe dream. They're starting to take off all over the globe. Judges are realizing we need urgent transformative change to address the environmental crisis. Legislators are starting to harmonize human-created laws with those laws created by nature. And the public is increasingly meeting its moral and legal responsibility to protect the natural world. I know that some audience members here today are folks with a strong connection to the great rivers, the Mississippi and the Missouri. And I know that many others are joining internationally, hoping to learn how to care for their local waterways based on some case studies from across the world. It's my hope that everyone here today can learn from our incredible speakers who will provide you with a variety of lessons from the United States, Latin America, the South Pacific, and beyond. And after tonight's event, I encourage you all to read or to reread the People's Resolution Honoring the Great Rivers, which is posted on the Global Freshwater Summit webpage. I'm sure you'll hear more about it tonight. This People's Resolution recognizes the shared responsibility of Mississippi River communities and all people to respect and steward the rights of rivers. And with that brief introduction, we can get started. We'll hear from each of our three speakers for about 7 to 10 minutes each. If any speaker gets up to the 9-minute mark, I'll turn on my mic and give you an audible 1-minute reminder. And then we're going to do a panel discussion with whatever time is left, probably about 20 minutes. And I will ask some follow-up questions to each of the speakers to guide the conversation. And then we will wrap up no later than 10 after. Okay, our first speaker today is the incredible Monti Aguirre. She works as part of International Rivers Latin America program to support local movements for the protection of rivers and to develop strategies for legally protecting rivers permanently. She's been a tireless supporter of those people affected by the Chicxulub Dam in Guatemala. Monti has a bachelor's degree in anthropology and a master's degree from New York University in environmental education and conservation. I've had the great honor of helping draft and promote with her the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Rivers. And welcome, Monti, you're on.
Thank you so much, Grant, and greetings to all of you. I'm Monti Aguirre. I would like to thank Myra Jackson from the UN Harmony with Nature and her team, Laura, the Missouri Historical Museum, and Grant, a great partner in this mission to protect rivers and working for the rights of nature, rights of rivers, for the opportunity that they have given to International Rivers to participate and contribute to what unites us today, all of us today, the well-being of rivers and all the living organisms that they sustain or that make a river. Protecting rivers and communities unite us all. Rights of nature, like Grant was saying, is the idea that nature possesses fundamental rights, just as humans do. The rights of nature movement has ancient roots arising from indigenous traditions that have always treated humans as part of nature rather than distinct from it. And in Western societies, the movement it's new, but it's rapidly developing and growing. Most rights of nature legal precedent has emerged in the last 15 years or so as a direct response to the failures of modern environmental law to adequately address the escalating ecological crisis. And it seeks to rewrite the legal system to work for the environment instead of against it. Rights of river have become a central focus in the rights of nature. Globally, river systems, as you know, are under extreme pressure. Many of the world rivers suffer from extraordinary overexploitation through extraction, damming, pollution, alteration of natural flow regimes, loss of water quality, and changes to riverine ecosystems, habitats, and watersheds. Rivers and freshwater ecosystems emerging from the earth, meandering through forests and this beautiful land that we live on, play a vital role in the hydrological cycle, climate stability, nutrient flows, biodiversity, conservation, and a host of ecosystem services that benefit all of humanity. The approaches to rights of rivers vary. Some are grounded, some of the cases, because it comes down to going to court, a lot of it, and developing the language, developing the concepts, in looking within us, in asking philosophical questions. But anyhow, we end up in court, most likely. So some of the cases that are grounded in indigenous jurisprudence and treaty rights, in others they're enacted as constitutional rights encoded within national laws or passed or executive actions. The cases also encompass sometimes local ordinances, often developed in situations where communities are countering federal inaction, as in the examples of the United States and Brazil. And we want to emphasize the critical importance of strategic litigation for this, addressing rights of rivers, of judicial action and court decisions that apply the law in new ways, according to emerging norms. The arguments provided in the cases and the decisions made by the court and some of the decisions, you gotta read some of them. They're beautiful, they're beautiful. We're talking about humans reconnected with nature in a sense. So check them out. I really like the Ganges and Yamuna decision, even though that's still, you know, still, we're still not done. Let's say our partners are still not done for the the case, but it's a beautiful, beautiful decision. So all this river jurisprudence contributes in improving water quality, conserving and restoring freshwater ecosystems, halting loss of biodiversity and natural habitat, rights of rivers arguments, reclaim land and forest from river destructive development, such as large scale hydropower dams and mining projects. For example, since the 2019 Bangladeshi High Court decision, over 4,000 illegal structures affecting river health have been demolished. I should say that, you know, the decision was to protect, to give rights to all the rivers in Bangladesh. Imagine that. So anyhow, so about 190 acres of land recovered and 231 unauthorized factories closed on the Buriganga River. The Colombian case, bit different, but resulted in mining prohibitions and action plans for restoration of degraded areas. And it's a work in progress. We're all learning. We're all learning. And we need all of us to do this work. Rights of River supports creating also a mechanism for recognizing the services provided by natural ecosystems beyond their economic value. And that's what's different. That's what's important. Guardianships, you know, rights of nature also speaks of guardianship entities established to implement rights of rivers, such as in the New Zealand Whanganui case, about which we'll hear later today, which upholds the territorial and stewardship rights of local and indigenous communities. We're speaking about rivers as having an independent and inalienable right to exist and flourish, to being recognized as right-bearing entities, and as such, they have rights that can be enforced by people, governments, communities, on behalf of nature. The rights of rivers are better said or established in the Universal Declaration of the Rights of Rivers. It was drafted initially by the Earth Law Center, incorporated comments from many others throughout the world. And the declaration establishes that all rivers shall possess at minimum the following fundamental rights: the right to flow, the right to perform essential functions within its ecosystem, the right to be free from pollution, the right to feed and be fed by sustainable aquifers, the right to biodiversity, and the right to regeneration and restoration. And as many of us, what many of us are also doing is seeking modifications to the existing laws and policies regarding rivers and freshwater ecosystems, and or the creation of new laws and policies that work in harmony with nature. Court decisions on the rights of river cases need a better landing, an adequate set of laws and policies in place that permanently protect rivers and other freshwater ecosystems, and, you know, protecting the rights of nature. And with the broader local and global movement, because we're growing, look at you, you're here. With you here present, supporting these rights, we can all help to bring legal shape to the ways in which rivers are valued and understood as sacred living entities, as holistic and interconnected ecosystems, and as watersheds incorporating water, land, forests, and communities. The legal recognition of rights of nature remains novel and faces implementation and enforcement challenges. In many cases, the practical impact is yet to be seen. However, experience from other right-based social movements, such as those the rights of women and indigenous people, demonstrate that even non-binding measures can often be effective in shifting social values, building movements, and working towards that paradigm change. Do you feel it? Do you feel that that's where we're going? We are going that way. Okay, I am in California, in the Russian River watershed. This is Pomo-occupied Pomo land. I am Monti Aguirre. I am originally from Colombia and I'm with International Rivers. Thank you.
Thank you, Monti. That was wonderful. And I second what you said about Rights of Rivers Court decisions being very beautiful. And, you know, I encourage all lawyers and all professionals to read those, as well as to, in general, read poetry and beautiful writing. And I think a lawyer and who's also a poet is a dangerous lawyer in the environmental world, because the writing's a lot more persuasive than it otherwise might be. So actually all my interns are required to read poetry in addition to working to save the planet. So our second speaker today is the amazing Gary Wockner. Gary currently consults for and represents environmental organizations in Colorado and the Southwest United States, including Save the Colorado. He received a PhD in environmental geography from the University of Colorado Boulder. He has worked for government, academic, and advocacy organizations, and he lives in Fort Collins, Colorado. Gary is an award-winning environmental writer and advocate. His website is garywockner.com. Check it out. And I have the privilege of working with Gary on some really exciting local rights of rivers models in Colorado. Welcome, Gary.
Thank you, Grant. How are you today?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks.
Good.
So thanks for that very kind introduction, Grant. I'm Gary Wockner. Fort Collins, Colorado is the Cache Laputa River runs through our community. It's named after a French word, which were some of the explorers that were here back in the 1800s. I also run a program around the Colorado River in the Western United States. The Colorado River starts just upstream of Fort Collins in Rocky Mountain National Park on the other side of the Continental Divide, and then flows, of course, downstream west through Colorado, through Utah, Arizona, and California, and then out to the Sea of Cortez, except for one big problem. The Colorado River is drained bone dry before it reaches the sea. My organization is called SaveTheColorado.org, and our mission is to protect and restore the Colorado River. And we have several programs that we focus on to try to get that done. One of them is Rights of Nature, which I'll get to here in just a few minutes. But the Colorado River has huge problems. As I said, it's drained dry. All 5 trillion gallons of water that naturally flow in the river every year are drained out before it reaches the Sea of Cortez in Mexico. There are massive dams on the Colorado River. In fact, the biggest dam is called Hoover Dam, and it is what we call the first cut. It was the origin of planetary river destruction. It actually started on the Colorado River with Hoover Dam, and of course that technology has now been transferred all across the planet with, you know, spectacularly destructive results. The Colorado River has endangered fish in it. It has a number of even proposed new dams. You'd think, well, it's already drained dry. How do they get even more water out of it? Well, they're trying to get more water out of it all the time. And in the Southwest United States, the Colorado River is also facing a big threat of climate change. There's kind of a bullseye on the Southwest United States for heat and drought, and we're seeing a lot of that right now. So it is wildly out of balance. That out of balance is really rooted in a problem of worldview, which Grant and Monti both kind of touched on at length. Rivers in the state of Colorado in particular, and rivers around the Southwest US, are both completely in the worldview of anthropocentrism, meaning that humans have complete dominion over nature. Where I live in Colorado, people use, exploit, devour the non-human world. They can own nature, landscapes, trees, rocks, wildlife, etc., including rivers, and just buy and sell it. In fact, you can buy and sell water right out of a river on the open market here in the state of Colorado. And so it is an example of dominion where our economy and our political system and our legal system is entirely rooted in humans owning the non-human world or owning nature as property. And I like to practice the opposite, which I call ecocentrism. Of course, not a new idea at all, but an ecocentric worldview is one that says that the non-human world has intrinsic rights to exist, that we humans do not have dominion over nature. And the non-human world has rights to not just exist, but also flourish. Rivers, that we're talking about today, we believe are living, breathing entities, the literal veins of the planet. And they have a right to exist, to flow, to thrive, to be free of dams and pollution, a right to restoration, and a right to evolution. So these are dramatically different worldviews in terms of what is controlling rivers and destroying rivers right now, compared to what, you know, we try to practice, which is much more ecocentric, that the rivers have a right to exist by themselves. So those are, you know, kind of heady concepts, of course, and both Grant and Monti touched on those, but how does that actually play out in a practical way? as an environmental activist and a person who directs organizations that try to protect rivers. So we try to stand up for the rights of rivers and the non-human world. We try to seek ecological justice while working within the current system. So I'd say we're sort of right at the edge of the system. We're trying to push it as far as we can our way, but we have to stay in the system. Otherwise, if you get out there too far, of course, you're not really engaged in the legal process, but in the media process, and you know, people don't really take it as seriously. So we try to exist right at the edge of the system. We interface with and enforce federal, state, and local environmental laws. We try to use those laws to protect rivers wherever we can. We file lawsuits and litigate commonly. We communicate with the public and media. We speak for that which cannot speak for itself, which is the non-human world and rivers in particular. We recently launched a new program, as Grant mentioned, working with Grant's organization, Earth Law Center, about rights of nature for rivers. And we're currently having conversations with about 10 communities around Colorado and Utah, looking at the concept of creating local municipal ordinances and resolutions, which create a process so that decision makers, whether it's a city council or town board, gets in the habit of thinking about, okay, that's what we're going to do on this particular issue. And then how does the river's voice enter into that? So the idea that there'd be guardians for those rivers and they'd have the opportunity to come before a decision-making body like a town council and speak for the river. So we're starting to move those processes forward here in the state of Colorado and in Utah and throughout the Colorado River Basin. Ultimately, in my opinion, one of the biggest lessons of climate change in the Colorado River is not just its impact on the river, but it's that human dominion is destroying not just the rivers, but also is destroying the planet. And we need to start thinking more about ecological justice. In the United States, of course, we've had a fascinating experience over the past year and a half around the issue of social justice. And we're trying to expand that concept of justice so that we can start thinking about justice for the non-human world also. I believe that water and rivers are alive and they need to be protected and restored. And that's how I imagine a new relationship with nature and people on the built environment. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Gary, that was great. And you know, I encourage everyone here, whatever your profession is or hobbies, to really consider how ecocentrism could play into that. I'm actually working with an IP lawyer to figure out how nature can own its own intellectual property. And so if a IP lawyer can embrace ecocentrism, anybody can. And now we move on to our final speaker tonight before we engage in a panel discussion. Our final speaker is the wonderful Catherine Iorns. She is a law professor at Te Haerenga Waka, the Victoria University of Wellington in Aotearoa, New Zealand. She has more than 25 years experience on environmental law, indigenous rights, international law, and statutory interpretation. and has received several awards for her teaching and research on the intersection between environmental law and Indigenous rights. She also contributed a brilliant chapter on New Zealand to the law school coursebook on earth law. Welcome, Catherine.
Thank you, Grant. Tēnā koutou katoa, ngā mihi ki te mana whenua, ngā mihi nui o te ata ki a koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā rā tātou katoa. That was just a brief welcome or greetings in Māori to the guardians of the land first, and then to all of you who have gathered here for this wonderful program. So what I'm going to do, I did my normal professor thing and prepared a brief PowerPoint. And so I'm going to share my screen and then you don't have to look at my, let me see, there we go. Actually, that's meant to be from the beginning, sorry. I had it at the beginning. There we go. The normal absent-minded professor who is also slow on the tech uptake. Yes, I'm coming to you actually from a farm in sort of rural New Zealand at a friend's house on a laptop on Wi-Fi. So I apologize for the not the standard setup and the almost black and white look, but I'm very happy to be here to contribute in any way I can to furthering the cause in that respect about I'm happy to call it rights of nature for now. Those who know me will think I don't normally use that term, but certainly more than happy to contribute to the rights and our responsibilities in respect of fresh water. So here's my theme, picking up on both what sort of Grant and Monti have said. This idea of legal personhood comes out of a movement. Well, it doesn't come out of a movement, but that's one of those key tools of the rights of nature movement. And so there's a lot of call for taking a different mindset and not thinking of our dominion about nature and thinking of that more ecocentric view. And a way to do that is one of the legal tools within our existing rights framework is to think of making it a legal person and giving it rights. Therefore, I mean, companies do it, right? You've given companies in the States rights of in relation or democratic rights. And you think of that one which the companies are allowed to donate to political parties in furtherance of, a normal democratic aim, right? Well, not everybody does that, but it's an example of how you can give rights to non-human entities. We also, give legal, and you do that through giving it legal personality. So this is one of those key tools that the rights of nature movement uses. Here in Aotearoa, New Zealand, we've taken a different tack. We've given legal personality to nature, but we don't talk of it in terms of rights of nature. We talk of it in terms of responsibilities. And so this is, if you want, the one takeaway is that I say responsibility is the invisible goal. Rights are extremely useful tools within our current legal systems and the rules that we have. But I suggest that responsibility and human responsibility for nature to uphold its interests, what you talk about a right to flow or a right to exist, but we say maybe we have the responsibility to accord that to nature, taking that more ecocentric view. So this is just the brief, 10-minute version. Before I did that, I thought I'd say I have given like the 45-minute version and within the Rights of Nature conference, this is a Vermont one a couple of years ago, I talked about how to include responsibilities in it with more examples, not just from New Zealand. So this is just a framework from that. So this is just a slide from that talk, and it's on YouTube, and there's a book chapter which sets it out in even more detail, free on SSRN. SSRN is a website, a repository of academic writings, and there's a whole bunch of those there. But I also thought, since Grant hasn't put it up, I added here's a slideshow of the Earth Law book, a PowerPoint slide rather, not a whole show, of the book where you can find out what's in it and order it. We're assuming that all the authors will get sent their copies soon, right, Grant? The examples in Aotearoa reflect the different mindset. And it's not necessarily an ecocentric view, as we've talked about, but it's definitely a different way of looking at nature. And the Maori worldview and a more indigenous worldview, and as an aside, I'll say all of us, and even the Western worldview, were pagan once. That's my line. We were all pagan once. And we worshipped natural gods, and we thought, some of them were ancestors, right? You know, the wind, the sun, the sky, the moon. So here's a quote about the Maori worldview, but there's similar quotes in relation to First Nations in North America, where kinship refers to that broad web of relationships between people, living and dead, and land, water, flora, and fauna, and the spiritual world. So a person's inner life force is intimately linked to that. This is the Maori, that's the spirit of others, to whom he or she is related. And that includes mountains, rivers, and lakes. And so you can talk to them in the same way as you talk to humans, and elders might speak directly to them. It might be talked of as a spirit world, but it's still the natural world as a direct link. So with that, as a kinship bond, there's a reciprocal set of obligations, and the Māori word for that is kaitiakitanga. You might say guardianship as the shortest term. It's an obligation to nurture and provide care. But it is more than just, say, stewardship or guardianship. It's a responsibility of the tribe such that it's reciprocal. So you don't exist as a tribe properly if you are not exercising those obligations, if you are not upholding your responsibilities. So that's the different worldview. And that worldview has led to sayings such as, for example, if you regard the river as your living ancestor, you have the Maori saying, a number of tribes, ko o te awa, ko te awa, ko o, I am the river and the river is me. Well, there's a transliteration. Of course, we all know that language is not just transliteration, it's a literal way of doing it. But it really means that the health and the well-being of, the, in this case, the Whanganui River, because that's the example, but the health and well-being of that, the awa, that water, is intrinsically connected to the health and well-being of the people. So if one is healthy, then the other is healthy, and vice versa. If the river is not healthy, then the people must not be healthy, certainly as a community, because that means they're not upholding their obligations of care. So that, so in relation to the example I've been asked to speak of, is that which is the Whanganui River, it's been given a name, Te Awa Tupua. That's kind of like the grandfather river and the ancestor river. And that's one in the North Island of New Zealand, which is on the left. And it starts in the middle near the mountains and winds its way down. You can see the very jiggity windy through a lot of hills and down to the coast at the town there of Whanganui. It goes through a lot of farmland. I mean, this starts off in a central forest. I cut down some of the pictures. In a national park, I should say, which is like a national reserve. And then through farmland, some of that, am I right? And was it Monti? One of the people on here has kayaked it, and it might have looked like that. It's very popular. It's the longest navigable river in New Zealand. And but it, as a result of colonization, control over the river and responsibility for it was taken away from the indigenous Maori. Riverbed, were the normal things that you would do when you have dominion and you think it's your property, right? Riverbed works, gravel extraction, water diversions, destruction of the eel weirs and the fish, nurseries that the Maori used. And that says objections were lodged by iwi. Iwi's the Maori word for a tribe. That includes numerous court cases from the early 1900s. It has been said to have been New Zealand's longest running court case over control of the river, you know, as a result of colonization. So there's a lot of argument about, over that time, but there was an agreement to negotiate with the government over those historical grievances in the 2010s. And that negotiation over the grievances is what do we do to resolve the grievances and provide reparations. There was an agreement that the river, the awa, would be given a legal personality, made a legal entity, given its own name, Te Awa Tupua, said that it would be incapable of being owned and that its innate values would be recognized and provided for. So you see, that matches what Monti was saying about an ecocentric view and Grant was saying about earth law, but we're doing it actually from an indigenous cosmology perspective. You know, it's not actually, we're not actually doing rights of rivers here. We're just providing reparations in accordance with indigenous and cultural views. And so that led to a piece of legislation. So it's different from most other examples where you've talked about rights of rivers. It was mentioned earlier about the river Ganga and Yamuna, right? Well, that was through court cases. And the same with the Bangladesh. This is more similar to Ecuador it's halfway between. Ecuador's between our statute and the cases because they set up a framework and a constitution, but then they leave it to courts to flesh that out in decisions. So we have a piece of legislation, and that picture is of the tribes and the government. There's the minister in charge there on the right, signing the legislation agreement. So it's they've recognized, and there's a section 12 from the statute. It says Te Awa Tupua is a legal person and has all the rights, powers, duties, and liabilities of a legal person. I know most people focus on rights. That's not what, there are no other rights defined in the statute, which is interesting. Sometimes it's treated as a body corporate. Okay, and a public entity, and of course it's vested title to the riverbed of the river in the legal person. So they created a legal person and then gave it title to its own self, which is very interesting. And not the water itself, that's a political discussion for another day. And it affects a lot of other statutes. So there's just some quotes that I think is really important as a feature to note. If you look at the bottom line, it's a whole catchment, but it includes metaphysical elements. It's a spiritual entity as well. There are guardians that have been established. The po is like a pole, right? Our crown and a tribal, and the guardian has to promote and protect the health and well-being of the river, act and speak on its behalf, and act in its interests, right? And consistently with the intrinsic values that are defined. So just if you want a summary of a focus, it's responsibilities of people, not rights of nature. Cultural redress, you get intrinsic worth, which is an earth law perspective, but otherwise not define the rights. And you have a transfer of property with a reparations money pot that enables those responsibilities to be exercised. I think I've said that. Yeah, I've already said this, responsibility, not rights, in the framework. So I felt if there's anything I want to leave you with, it's this. I mean, Indigenous peoples aren't the only ones who believe in responsibility, but it's one that's inherent in the worldview, which gives back to we need to regard nature in a different way. This is the view from where I live across my harbour. So I leave you with the saying, ko au te awa, ko te awa, ko au, I am the river is me. And it would be a lovely different worldview for everybody to take. So now I'll stop my share and very happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you, Catherine. And you mentioned that we give rights to companies, so why not nature? And actually, in a sort of ironic twist, I'm working with a company in Hawaii so that the ocean itself can have an ownership stake in the company and actually serve on the board of directors. And so the ocean's going to help run the company, make decisions through a legal guardian, and so forth. So again, really any field can become ecocentric if you're a little bit imaginative. And I like to think that the extension of this initiative is that the ocean could, in the future, engage in hostile takeovers of polluting companies. Wouldn't that be fun?
I'm very sorry. I noticed, I attributed a number of Gary's statements to Monti. I'm really sorry. Just in the thinking about what I'm saying, not paying attention to the names.
Okay, well, they've both done lots of cool things. So props to both of them. But all right, so on to our final segment of tonight's event, which is the panel discussion. And during today's preparations, I tried to channel the audience's collective inquiries and skepticisms, come up with some interesting questions that I hope will spur some discussion and further insights for the audience. And I'm gonna start with Gary. Gary, There's about 84,000 dams in the United States, and that includes an estimated 17,200 dams and reservoirs in the Missouri River watershed. And you have a knack for explaining very complicated things very simply. And so my question is, how were so many dams approved in the United States, and what's missing from our laws that allowed this to happen? And then relatedly, if the rights of rivers is adopted in the United States, can that push back against the onslaught of dams and even lead to widespread dam removal?
Yeah, thanks, Grant, for that question. The vast majority of dams in the United States were built before the advent of modern American environmental laws. So the laws that we most usually work with at the federal level are the National Environmental Policy Act, the Clean Water Act, and the Endangered Species Act. And almost all dams were built before those were passed in the late 1960s and 1970s. There are still some dams that are getting built now, and it's I just am finishing a couple processes that have literally lasted 20 years, the permitting processes for these projects, and that's because we do have environmental laws. Unfortunately, the laws we have now are, they exist, but they're not super strong, those three federal laws, and so it still doesn't necessarily or rarely actually stops the construction of new dams. Every state's a little bit differently. Here in Colorado, I would say our laws around protecting rivers are fairly weak because it's the kind of state where it's obviously a dry strait, and so all the water in the rivers is owned and bought and sold continually. You know, some states are a little better. I think California tries to move in the right direction. It just kind of depends where you are in the United States. Also at the local level, there are laws, and I get to interface with a number of cities and counties. And so cities and counties in the state of Colorado, for example, can have their own laws. Sometimes those can be very strong, especially county laws. And so we kind of use whatever's available to try to do the work. If rights of rivers pass and rights of nature pass for rivers, I mean, I would say, you know, it's a long process, as we all know very well. And you know, I think there's like a wave just starting to curl away out there in the ocean, and it hasn't even close to gotten to shore yet or starting to break on this issue, but it's at the beginning of the conversation. We're trying to create broader conversations around rivers' right to exist and not to be dammed, and then to communicate better with the public about the impacts of dam. So I think, you know, the truth is we can only go up. We can only get better really in the United States around the legal system that protects rivers.
Great, thank you, Gary. My next question is for Monti. Similar to the one to Gary, you also fight against dams, especially in Latin America. And in South America, almost 6 million people live downstream from dams and are negatively affected by them. And I know you've won a lot of anti-dam campaigns, but in those campaigns that weren't successful, what was missing? And with the rights of rivers movement really taking hold in Latin America, where it's starting to become bread and butter law, how do you think this can impact the future of dam construction there?
Thank you. International Rivers, we continue to work to stop really bad hydro projects that impact lots of communities, not only local communities, indigenous peoples. Well, you all know about that. But and it's true, we were able to stop many projects. But what we were able to see is that, for example, the Belo Monte project in Brazil, that was stopped in the 80s, you know. Even Sting was involved, you know, the singer Sting was involved in that campaign, I remember. And it got stopped at the Supreme Court. But then 10 years later, it came back, like a ghost came back. So what was not in place then, that a huge dam, we're seeing all the consequences now, and they're huge on the indigenous people especially. And the river has been altered completely. This is my alarm for you. Sorry. So what was missing what is missing? It's laws. If we, let's say that we agree that that we should organize ourselves through a law system, you can say it better than I, but the laws that are in place are laws that are more for the responding to the needs of development, of mining companies, of companies, you know, infrastructure development companies and so forth, but are not looking at the rights of people, at the rights of the river, or the importance of having the rivers in place. I think that's really important. And then looking forward, there's of course a whole lot more to say, but looking forward, okay, here's what I'm detecting. It's that, first of all, the rights of nature, rights of movement, it's very, people understand it generally very easily. It's something that it registers in their consciousness, subconsciousness, or at that level, you know, it registers. It has also an emotional connection. I don't know if you feel, but you know, people do. There have been times when I've spoken about it in certain communities, and it's been really interesting to see the reaction. So what I'm saying is that the rights of rivers, rights of nature movement, it's something that many people can really understand and see. What we are lacking, it's the implementation. That's one of the greatest challenges, as I said, is the implementation. What does it mean once a beautiful core decision is emitted? You know, how does it land? What are you supposed to do then? But now we have several years of experience and we are starting to see some results, you know? So I can definitely, and also I must say that there's a shift, there's a change. I see, for example, in Chile, people working towards a new constitution, same thing as in Peru, whether it's an amendment or not. In Colombia, there's talk about that. In Brazil, there's talk about that. We have a rights of nature group in Brazil, and that's some of the discussions are also about, you know, does it become binding, right? Because that's what everybody's waiting for. Binding, is it binding or not, to what level? And how are we gonna do it? We're supposed to not touch the river, never fish anymore? Of course not. Of course not. This is when we need to talk. This is when these decisions in court, and that sort of, in a sense, you know, that conversation really helps. Oh, I've talked too much. All right, thank you.
That was really helpful and encapsulated kind of the progression and momentum of the movement. My next question is for Catherine Iorns. You're a professor, and I would assume you see more students wanting to enter the fields of earth law and rights of nature and ecocentric law and so forth. And if so, what's the reason for this increased interest compared to more traditional, and let's be honest, financially lucrative careers? And I should know. And in addition to asking about why there's this increased interest, do you think this is a field of study that should become mandatory education for students, or should it be more of a special interest area for a select few? And you're on mute.
Yes, I was just looking for it. Of course, I think that needs to be mandatory, but it's not just earth law. I think we actually, what needs to be mandatory is this idea of the world view we have is not the only one that's ever existed. You know how it's like where the fish swimming in the water wondering where's the ocean, you know, that old saying. It's like you're in it and people don't know it, and there it's just normal. And it's a education about constitutions. You do constitutional law and you typically only teach your country's own, and you don't realize how different it is from others, and where ours is really unusual, and yet we take it as normal. I think we need mandatory education about, it's like, what these relationships are and the trajectory, the history, and this links in with why I think people are doing it. As soon as people find out, not necessarily about the worldviews, but as soon as people find out about what's actually happening, You know, there's that lovely thing, what's the news you get on TV? You know, it's like who's done what to whom, and especially sort of celebrity stuff. And what's actually happening in the real world around you, the natural world. I always have, I'll be honest, a whole week typically of doom and gloom in my environmental law lectures. And people are, you know, gym students are shell-shocked. Some students work really, some people generally work really well for deadlines. You know how you're a deadline person and you go, if you know how bad it is, it spurs you to action. Other people, it's like, you know how bad it is and it shocks you into retreating into a cave and hiding under the blankets. So, and you know, we go through that explicitly, but as soon as you actually learn how bad the state is of the natural world around you, most people want to do something if they can. And I, and so there's another two things. One, it's a field of mandatory education. it's like embedding yourself in the real world. But then also people who do find out about it usually want to do something about it. And I think in terms of that, all those different careers, we got a lot of, and I want to say polarizing, I mean, we've got a lot of polarization, but it's like they're becoming stronger at the more extreme ends. You think of the neoliberal, no, it was libertarian. We'll say the libertarian view that's coming out of the IT, the Silicon Valley. I mean, we have billionaires buying land in New Zealand as bolt holes, and a lot of them are from Silicon Valley. You know, that we know that here. I don't know how much that's common knowledge there. But this idea that therefore tax regimes should go down, therefore, you know, we should control our own destiny. We're little individuals that can ride out any storm. Well, humans didn't evolve that way. Humans evolved in tribes, and you had to be together for security and all of that stuff. We're not actually, you know, survive, but this false disconnection from the real world enables really strong arguments about the role of governments, you know, the role of law, all of those things, who has rights for what and where the money goes. And it's usually, and on one end, and it's to individuals who've made it, and other end, it's to, you know, money is not important. We should be just being able to live within the bounds, or else everything's going to be wiped out. You know, there will not be a future by 2050 if we don't change these things. I mean, we're talking that lack of civilization and that wider sense of not a civilized, you know, we will not be behaving in a civilized manner towards each other if we don't fix these things by 2050. So as soon as people realize that, the students are thinking about that, and they go, damn, you know, we've got to do something. So I think that it's, yeah. And then you realize it doesn't matter how much money you make if it's all going to go to hell in a handbasket around you, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, thank you. I think every environmental advocate has said damn and does so pretty frequently.
Okay. Well, because you say worse than that, but you know, that's kind of, that's about all you're allowed.
Yeah, damn, and then here's what we're going to do to fix this. So we have 4 minutes left. I think we can squeeze in a lightning round, minute maximum, just to put in a couple more interesting questions. If I'll go through the three folks again, if you can just give me a really quick answer, and I'm sure there's a lot more explanation you can't say. Gary, under the status quo, it's common for laws and politicians and so forth to have this approach of, we need to balance economic and environmental interests. And sometimes you balance so much that, you know, really environment is last on your list and the economy is first. Do you think balancing is the right approach to river protection? And if not, what should the standard be?
He's on mute.
Oh, you're on mute, Gary.
I'd be happy with balance, because right now most of the rivers are drained way more than 50%. If we could just get back to like 50-50, it'd be a dramatic improvement for most of the rivers in the state of Colorado. So balance is a good idea. Unfortunately, whenever, you know, politicians see balance, like every project that comes along, they say, well, let's just balance it. So they take out a little bit, and the next time they balance it again, the next time they balance it again, and it's death by a thousand cuts. It's just completely balanced to death all the time. You know, humans are also, and Americans are voracious consumers, and we're wildly out of balance. There's an organization called the Global Footprint Network based in San Francisco. It calculates how much of the earth we consume every year. Americans consume like 5 times more resources than we have here, and the planet's doing the same thing. You know, I would also say it's really important to bring up the idea of population balance. There are just way too many people on the planet to have a reasonable balance, and in the United States too.
Okay. Thank you, Gary. We need real balance. Monti, quick one for you. I'm an obsessive fantasy basketball player. I always research who's the next great player no one's talking about. And so in the rights of nature or ecocentric law field, is there a country or state or place that no one's really talking about, but that could become a leader in this field?
She's on mute.
You're on mute, Monti.
Sorry about that. I think we have. There's a very good possibility that we'll see some, article in the Constitution of Chile, Rights of Nature, perhaps. I think there is right now a law on the rights of nature being discussed in, it's going to the plenary in Peru. Also in Peru, there is a rights of rivers law being developed. And also in Peru, there is a rights of guardian already in Congress. It hasn't had the first discussions. In Colombia, we're also talking about, rights of nature amendment in the Constitution. And overall, really developing cases, because I think that building jurisprudence is really important. And I'm past my 2 minutes or a minute. But yes, this is happening. This is happening.
Okay, it's happening everywhere. Lots of excitement. Final question for the night, Catherine Iorns. Taking a different track, the Whanganui River case study and other case studies in New Zealand are often described as rights of nature precedent, but really there's a lot more nuance, as you talked about, because it's really an indigenous manifestation of belief systems and also sort of a compromise on, a movement for indigenous sovereignty within New Zealand. Should we stop calling the Whanganui case study rights of nature because it's an oversimplification? Any comments on that?
Simple answer would be yes, you have to stop. It's not a rights of nature example because of the way it arose, as I've described. It's a reparations. And so in that sense, it's a human rights. It's an indigenous rights example to have reparations for their grievance about lands and other resources taken from them. Every, colonized country, Turtle Island, whole of North America, could be adopting a guardianship framework based on these indigenous cosmologies if you were interested in reparations. I know there's been, Canada's doing a lot in that area, but, and so if you just put on a different lens and talk about responsibility, you don't have to be indigenous to think about responsibility. I mean, if you think about children, have some rights. They don't have all their responsibility because they're not, fully formed in that sense of fully responsible. So it's not the same, we have different types of rights and responsibilities and things that legal persons have. But obviously we're not a rights example, but I understand we use the same tools that the rights of nature movement and earth law. I mean, rights of nature was chosen as a phrase that resonates as a movement, as a political goal, right? And it works for the political goal. I totally understand that. It's just that it then forces everyone to have the same paradigm that a liberal idea of rights might be the solution to everything. And of course it's not. So that's the only drawback with that. So if we can expand it, that's why I like the phrase earth law. And I love the way you've talked about your textbook as an earth law textbook. It's not a rights of nature, which is the narrow aspect. Sorry, I was going to stop at just yes.
Well, thank you for the plug at the end. So that's the last question of the night. I'd like to extend a huge thanks to our panel members, Gary, Monti, and Catherine. I would also like to thank the organizers of the Global Freshwater Summit. If you liked this session, be sure to share the video. I see a recorded live on Facebook logo, and so it's on the web. Share it with your friends and family, post it online, increase awareness. And a final concluding remark, in this moment of great ecological calamity for rivers and ecosystems, I think that today's presenters have made clear that we need urgent and transformative change, and now we have some of the legal mechanisms to achieve that. So I encourage everyone to think and act boldly, including on behalf of the great rivers, the Mississippi and Missouri, that are the topic of this summit. Thank you, everyone, and have a great evening.
Thank you. That's great, Grant.
Thank you so much, Grant. Thank you to all of our panelists, Catherine and Monty and Gary, for all of you taking the time and energy to be with us today. That was really enlightening. I appreciate all of that.